watch your futures end.
They invade our space, and we fall back. They assimilate entire worlds, and we fall back. The line must be drawn here.
Meeting.
Parker.
Acton.
Engage.
Journey to the far reaches of the universe in a behind-the-scenes look at Star Trek First Contact.
I think the Borg are the coolest bad guys we've ever met on Star Trek.
Don't let them touch you! They've adapted.
The special effects are spectacular, but also very beautiful. I was doing things I've never done before. It was great.
Always, you have the best time playing the bad guy.
Don't be frightened.
I'm not frightened.
It is about terror. It's about the unknown.
What's at stake is the future of the universe. Other than that, not much.
Data, put Starfleet frequency 1486 on audio.
Aye, sir.
A Borg cube on course 0 Mark 215.
On screen.
We are aboard. Lower your shields and surrender your ships. Your culture will adapt to service us. Resistance is futile. We are aboard.
Warp core breach. All hands abandon ship.
Star Trek First Contact is the eighth film in the continuing adventures of the Starship Enterprise.
Here we go. Quiet, please.
This story pits the Enterprise crew against their greatest adversaries, the Borg, a group of cybernetically enhanced aliens whose quest is to dominate the universe.
Roll it.
C-marker.
The film reunites the cast of Star Trek Generations under the direction of Jonathan Frakes.
Action.
And shake.
For the cast, reuniting on the bridge of the Enterprise was like getting together with old friends.
It has been so much fun to be back. I must say, it just got better and better, and when we finally hit the bridge, it's like no time has passed. It could have been last week or last month that we were doing this as the TV show. It's the same feeling.
It hasn't been that much of a reunion for the cast because we see each other all the time. And it's fun to have the characters hang around each other again, too.
It is an intriguing sensation. A most distracting...
Data, I'm sure it's a fascinating experience, but perhaps you should deactivate your emotion chip for now.
Good idea, sir.
These people have become among my closest and dearest friends. And so I'm in touch with them wherever I am, wherever they are.
I think that's what you see in a lot of the character relationships is our own friendships as people, and they come through the characters.
Mr. Worf,
I think you're the bravest man I've ever known.
Thank you, sir.
We do have a great time. I think we have a great time to the point of sometimes the crew are like, when are these guys going to stop messing around? But it was fun.
Mark. Action.
The plan losing what?
I think that's a print on that one, Jerry.
The new members of the cast were surprised by the atmosphere on the set.
When you watch the show, you figure the whole cast, since it's such, you know, a drama-filled show, that everybody would be really tense and really uptight and really straightforward. Not even close. I mean, these people are the biggest cut-ups.
Mr. Hawk, pursued course. Engage.
Cut!
That's great.
Oh, no!
For Patrick Stewart, it was a pleasure to be back in the captain's chair, issuing orders that have now become popular catchphrases.
Make it so. Make it so. Crept up on us in the series. I don't think anyone was aware when the phrase was first written that it was going to become for the next generation what Beam Me Up, Scotty, or He's Dead, Jim, became for the first series, the classic Trek series.
Red alert! Red alert!
Fire! Make it so. Make it so.
Make it so.
Make it so.
Helm, warp one.
Warp two. Warp factor eight. Engage.
Engage. Engage. Engage.
I know someone who's a flight crew with an airline that I cannot name, but they tell me that on the flight deck they continually use Star Trek language, and make it so is one of the things that they're saying.
Step on it.
In their past voyages, the Generation's crew has encountered the most lethal villains in the universe, from the Klingons and Cardassians to the evil Sorin. But Picard and his team face their greatest challenge in the Borg.
They are a species who assimilate many different races. And through this assimilation process, they have become almost automaton-like individuals with no independence, no mind of their own.
They say, we want you to be like us, and we're going to roll over you because we are the majority and we are in power.
Data!
We know that they deal in with a collective mind, with a collective voice. We also know that they fly in cube-like ships that are quite impenetrable. When they're like a swarm of ants going across a picnic table.
Captain, they've adapted. Regroup on deck 15. Don't let them touch you!
They have one leader, the Borg Queen, who controls the entire Borg hive, if you will.
I am the beginning, the end, the one who is many.
It's an entrance that I think I will never be able to top. Never again will I have such an entrance.
I am the Borg.
She's the fountainhead of it all. She's it. She's the intelligence that animates the Borg.
By assimilating other beings into our collective, we're bringing them closer to perfection.
Somehow, I question your motives.
That is because you haven't been properly stimulated yet.
Creating a unique look for the Borg was the job of Academy Award-winning makeup artist Michael Westmore, who designed more than 100 alien looks for the next generation.
I tried to keep it in the world we know. There's a bit of humanistic quality in the alien races we run into. Hence, a lot of races are foreheads and noses and things, because we can associate with them.
It was the combination of human and android qualities that Westmore brought to the look of the Borg.
The biggest challenge with the Borgs was trying to make them look more functional. As a machine, we'd put holograms in the eyes, LCDs in the eyes, blinking lights, just anything we could to give more action to the face.
Get around.
Well, a mouthful of eyepiece here.
When I realized I was going to have 36 of these things to build, I had to get a little creative. And each one of the eyes blinks out in Morse code a different person's name. This one is blinking out Rick Berman. Jonathan Frakes had my dad. You have to kind of know where the start is and where the stop is. Otherwise, it just reads as garbage.
Applying the Borg makeup to each actor took up to 4 hours.
We have so many different pieces. We have pieces that wrap around the head all the way. We have pieces, individual ones that go on each ear. We've got chunks that go on the head. We've got tubings running in the face. It's such a challenge to the makeup artist. It's huge. And it isn't all makeup, it's the suit, having to get dressed in the suit.
Parker.
My call time was 6 a.m., so we've been averaging about 5 hours in makeup and wardrobe total.
It takes us about an hour and a half to get them dressed.
Off your back.
We took our Borg actors and we had body casts made. Each costume is individually molded.
It's hot.
So it takes quite a while.
I used to be 350 pounds. Now I'm about 180.
Special armature was added as a final touch to the Borg costumes.
It's pretty much servo controlled, which is the servos I use for model airplanes and stuff by radio. And I control this function and this function and this function. We have a modified stun gun that's inside here. 80,000 volts, but it's completely safe.
And rolling.
By far, the most elaborate Borg makeup was reserved for the Queen.
All in all, it took about 6.5 hours to put on the makeup and then the suit. It's wonderful as an actor to be able to transform so hugely. I guess that's what I consider to be my job as an actor, is to transform. It's quite wonderful.
In the story of First Contact, the Enterprise crew time travels to Earth in the 21st century. They find a vulnerable world devastated by nuclear war and defenseless against the Borg, whose goal is to assimilate the planet and change history. The key to the Borg conquest lies with a man named Zefram Cochrane.
Let me just make sure that I understand you correctly. Of cybernetic creatures. I've traveled back through time to enslave the human race. And you're here to stop them?
That's right.
Zefram Cochrane,
he's a rocket scientist.
And he's sort of a maverick, you know, a throwback to the 1960s. And he develops warp speed.
Engage!
He represents to the post-21st century what perhaps the Wright brothers, the aviators, represent to us in the 20th century.
He's the guy who started the whole idea of our being able to travel faster than light, which means our being able to get to other worlds.
Zefram Cochrane is actually the guy who starts Star Trek.
And you people, you're all astronauts on some kind of Star Trek.
Cochrane is played by Academy Award nominee James Cromwell, who had appeared in several episodes of The Next Generation.
When we were creating the character, we always had Jamie in our head. And then Babe came along, and all of a sudden he was nominated for an Academy Award, and we thought, oh my God, we're not gonna get him. He's too big for us now. But because we had worked with him on a number of occasions, we were delighted that he did, in fact, take the role.
Coming from the future, where Cochrane is a legend, the Enterprise crew confronts a man quite different from their expectations.
History has painted Cochrane as this great visionary, and it's amazing to us to realize that he's just a guy.
We all grew up hearing about what you did here.
Really?
You're standing almost on the exact spot where your statue's gonna be.
Statue?
Oh, yeah.
Because I am supposed to be able to deal with people better than anybody else, they send me to meet with him, and he actually is a huge challenge for Troy because he insists on making her drink with him before he even talks to her.
88B, take one.
To the Phoenix. May she rest in peace.
Cut. Once again, gang.
Take two.
May she rest in peace.
Cut.
To see Counselor Troy under the influence of five or six shots of tequila is worth the price of admission alone.
Mark. Action.
May she rest in peace.
Troy's real pretty, so I introduce her to tequila of sorts. It's sort of a home brew and rock and roll.
Rolling.
To shoot Cochrane's rocket installation, the filmmakers traveled to Green Valley, Arizona, the site of a deactivated Titan II missile silo.
Finding a missile silo and being able to bring our characters into a 21st century setting that was so real and so awesome in its scope was a real treat.
It was an actual ICBM missile in its tube 100 feet down underground. So it was the real thing.
Isn't it amazing? This ship used to be a nuclear missile.
And we wrote scenes to take advantage of the look of the missile silo itself. It was at a location that we couldn't have built for millions of dollars.
Cochrane's partner in the Warp Speed project is Lily Sloan, played by Academy Award nominee Alfre Woodard.
I got a script and I was very excited because Jonathan is an old dear friend of mine. So I read it and within the first 10 pages, I was hooked. It was thrilling, it was exciting. And you find yourself like really pulling for people. So I was thoroughly enamored. And of course, I really wanted to be in it.
Picard to Enterprise, energize.
Lily, I think she's a bit of a romantic adventurer, but she's been trapped by her circumstance.
Hurry up, Father! We're here to help you!
Captain, this woman requires medical attention.
She is brought on board the Enterprise because she suffers a heavy dose of radiation.
You want to help me? Get me out of here!
You want a way out? Here it is. Welcome aboard, Lily.
I think she's in awe of this ship. I mean, this ship is like you've died and gone to heaven.
Perhaps the most famous spacecraft in the history of the movies is the Enterprise. Over the course of the Star Trek adventures, there have been four versions of the ship. In the last film, the Enterprise D was destroyed in an incredible crash landing, with Deanna Troi at the controls.
The Enterprise does crash, and she had been the last person left in charge on the bridge, so the running gag has been that we gave her the keys and she crashed the car.
Well, they're all blaming me because I was driving, but I feel like I have to say that I think the planet we crashed into just came out of nowhere. I don't know where it came from.
Bringing the adventures of the new Enterprise E to the screen was second nature to Frakes, who had directed several episodes of The Next Generation.
He brought one thing that no one else could have brought, which is the experience of being an actor directing his own fellow actors. He has all of that history, the history of knowing all of us, the history of knowing what Star Trek is. And he has talent for directing actors, which is quite extraordinary, and rare, too.
I found Jonathan to be an endless source of energy, which has always been true. I mean, Jonathan has more energy than anybody I've ever met.
Action!
This is a big movie, and it's a major physical piece that he had to control.
Art! That's it. That's it. You get that?
Yes.
Great.
All right, picture, picture.
It was a treat getting up every morning, and it was at times overwhelming, at times exhausting, but generally it was better than I dared dream.
The gun gag is working great. And the acting from the Klingon. Oh.
I will say that the days that I had to work both as an actor and a director were a little more complicated up here and a little more all-consuming.
Cut.
Some of Star Trek's most exciting adventures have involved time travel. In The Next Generation, the crew developed a virtual reality device called the Holodeck to journey through time and space.
Computer, exit. Although objects appear solid on the holodeck, in the real world, they have no substance.
Picard and his crew have traveled everywhere, from Victorian England to the Old West, to the deck of an 18th century ship.
Computer, remove the plank.
First contact finds Picard and Lily entering the holodeck with the Borg in hot pursuit.
Perhaps something is sad.
They travel to the 1940s, where Picard takes on the persona of a detective character he created in The Next Generation.
Well, 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 look what the cat dragged in. What's shaking, Dick?
The usual, Nick. Martinis and skirts. Excuse me.
In the series, we established that Picard was a detective thriller fan, particularly the exploits of a character called Dixon Hill, who is a Philip Marlowe-like gumshoe. And one of the more charming sequences in the film is a holodeck sequence, which takes us back into mid-1940s America.
The filmmakers recreated the sequence at the landmark Union Station, where Patrick Stewart found a personal connection.
I'm a railway buff, so when I first came to Los Angeles, one of the first things I did was to go down and take a look at Union Station. But I had no idea that this particular room existed. It is a perfectly preserved replica of a late Art Deco interior. And then to see this transform into a 1940s nightclub was absolutely beautiful.
That was a movie magic day, to have hundreds of extras in period costumes, a full 18-piece dance orchestra, five cameras, explosion, Borg, Patrick looking like 007, Alfred in the gorgeous gold lamé.
Try and look as if you're having a good time.
You know, it was great. It was like running into the holodeck because suddenly we were in another film. I got to turn into a completely different person. Right in the middle of, you know, this film and this character and this danger. And I think for Lily, she loses herself in that moment.
No, 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 look at me. Try to act naturally.
Picard needs to disable at least one of the Borg so that he can acquire some information from them. So he lays his hand on a Tommy gun, an authentic Thompson submachine.
Got him.
Picard's aggression for the Borg stems from a past experience with them. In a classic episode of The Next Generation, the Borg kidnap Picard and make him one of their own.
I am Locutus. Resistance is futile.
Picard was abducted by the Borg, taken onto their ship, and was partially assimilated, not fully, as we were to discover. He managed to hold on to some aspects of his identity.
He's regaining consciousness. How do you feel?
Almost human.
In this film, Picard finds his leadership in question as a result of his past.
Captain, why are we out here chasing comets?
Let's just say, Starfleet has every confidence in the Enterprise and her crew. They're just not sure about her captain.
Starfleet are concerned because he was once assimilated by the Borg, and they don't trust that he's not somehow still connected with them.
He has an understanding of the Borg that no one else does, including memories that he is not even aware of, that he becomes aware of during the course of the story.
What?
I can hear them. Picard's view of this situation is that he is the ideal person to be in conflict with the Borg because he has an intuitive understanding of who they are and what they want.
It looks like the control deck's 26 up to 11.
He'll assimilate the Enterprise and then Earth.
While Picard works to resolve his past, the Borg turn their attention to Data, Starfleet's resident android.
They are part machine, part organic. Data's all machine. And the bottom line for him is his aspiration to become human.
For 34 years, I have endeavored to become more human, to grow beyond my original programming. This emotion chip may be the only answer.
For Spiner, it is the human aspect of Data that has made him an interesting character to play.
Data, I think, has a very light quality. Lately, in the films particularly, he's had more opportunity to have a taste of that.
Open sesame!
You could say, I have a magnetic personality.
Humor! I love it!
In this story, the Borg see Data as their key to taking over the Enterprise.
He is, shall we say, intriguing to them in a very special way. The Borg Queen is quite attracted to our android, Mr. Data.
There's an extraordinary fascination for his intelligence. And as you get to know Data, I think it would be very hard not to fall in love with Data, whoever you were. Your goal should be the same as ours.
Your goal is to obtain the encryption codes for the Enterprise computer.
But in order to reach it, I'm willing to help you reach yours.
The creators of Star Trek have always broken new ground in state-of-the-art special effects. In the various TV series and feature films, we've previewed vehicles of the future, explored the far corners of the universe, and experienced incredible battles in space.
Lock the phases and return fire.
Star Trek First Contact takes us to the next level of special effects, created by Industrial Light and Magic.
One of the keys to any science fiction movie is having wonderful visual effects. And we live in a time now where one movie after another is outdoing the previous one.
This is a sexier shot.
That's looking better.
ILM have been with us on this movie almost every day on the set. There is so much that they're involved in.
One of the film's key sequences takes place on the Deflector Array, an area outside the Enterprise that repels asteroids and other space debris from the path of the ship.
We do have one scene which takes place on the hull of the ship.
How are you doing, Mr. Wolf?
Not well, sir.
Try not to look at the stars.
And three of us, we encounter Borg in the area of the Deflector Array.
They're getting ready to signal their friends in another part of the galaxy, and we're out there to stop them. And it's going to be a spectacular scene.
The elements that went into creating this sequence included high-tech props, blue screen backgrounds, pyrotechnics, and complex stunts. As the Borg pursue them across the array, Picard and his crew find themselves in zero gravity.
We're attached to the ship by magnetized boots. But if you release the magnets, then you know, you're free to float.
To simulate weightlessness, the actors themselves were required to suit up for the situation.
It's just like being in a body brace. They hook these things on you, on the side, and they say, well, we got a great idea. We'll hook them in these harnesses and pull them over the side.
Parker,
action.
I had one particular scene when I pushed off and kind of did an aerial acrobatic flight across the top of this dish, which was actually done by controlling us on wires. I'd never flown before in the sense of flying, you know, and it was a lot of fun.
By scaling new heights in their journeys through space, Picard and the Enterprise crew continue to reach for the stars.
Engage.
Star Trek First Contact is one adventure they will not soon forget.
I think it's going to be both astonishing and frightening to see the finished result.
The sense of fun is back in Star Trek.
Maximum setting. If you fired this, you would have vaporized me.
It's my first ray gun.
And the action stuff, I think, will speak for itself.
Fire.
Perhaps today is a good day to die.
I really enjoyed it. I felt really that we were doing action hero stuff this time.
Yeah, I get to kick some Borg ass and all kinds of other stuff, and it's just a good time.
I must say, it's a wonderful story.
Let's rock and roll!
Can you think of a greater gift than to be projected into the future to be able to just see it? I mean, it's amazing.
Make it so.
HBO. When America's top forensic pathologists discuss their most mystifying cases, we literally